really important chapter in Alabama's history, and it's just a pleasure to be a part of the Humanities Foundation's effort to make programs like this possible. It's really, really neat thing that we have going on in Alabama now with the celebration of our bicentennial, and learned some interesting facts about Shelby County just now. And every county, every community has some of those interesting stories that I hope this will be an opportunity for us to explore. What I thought I'd talk about today is more or less an overview of how we got from this, the Mississippi Territory, to the state of Alabama. Because that chapter in Alabama history, 1798 to 1825, which is what I'll focus on, is that formative era that I think that even those of us who like local history and know a good bit about it, probably it's that era we know the least about. If you know anything about Alabama history, it seems like a lot of people's understanding of what happened really picks up right after this, when we go into the antebellum era. And a lot of people are real hazy about how we got from being a colonial held a colony of a foreign country to being a territory to being a state. Some of it's kind of confusing, some of it's kind of straightforward. But what I want to do is I want to try to move fairly quickly to help you understand the geography, the political boundaries, how that got formed, who moved in, how governments were being established, what the major issues were, and the major political issues, social issues of the day. So you have a better feel, I hope by the end of it, a better feel for what early Alabama, the real foundations of the state, were really like. So I call it From Territory to State, the story of Alabama. Real quick, I want to point out where we're talking about. Everybody knows some of the geography here, but that little strip in yellow, the gold color there, the Mississippi Territory, that is the original Mississippi Territory. This is a better map to illustrate it. When the Mississippi Territory was first established, we can do a whole other presentation on why that was the original Mississippi Territory. It had to do with disputes between the United States claiming territory and where the Spanish claimed the boundary was. So from the 31st parallel, which is right above Mobile there, and that pink area that shaded to that line is just above the Montgomery area in central Alabama below Fort Jackson, between 31st parallel and 32nd degrees, 28 minutes, long disputed portion of territory, and basically the United States said their border went all the way down to the 31st parallel. Spain said no, it was a little bit higher. Whole backstory there we don't have time to get into, but when that was settled, to the satisfaction of the United States, which means they decided they claimed the territory of Spain, relinquished it, they immediately established a territory, and they called it the Mississippi Territory. It, of course, its western boundary was on the Mississippi River, and its eastern boundary on the Chattahoochee River. Southern boundary is there with the border of what was then the Spanish colony of West Florida. So that is the original section of land that's going to be the Mississippi Territory. Now to that is added in 1804 everything to the north to the Tennessee line. We'll talk about that in a second. And then to the south, you've got the colony of East and West Florida. They're going to come into American possession sort of piecemeal. And I'll hit on a little bit of that as we move through so you understand how that happened. Has anybody been down in Mobile ever seen the sign or stopped and walked to see the Ellicott Stone? Just want to mention that because one of the things to understand about this territorial period is that one of the borders was a foreign country at the time. And so a lot of people don't quite understand that. Ellicott Stone is just north of Mobile, Highway 43. It's one of the last remaining surveyed stones placed by Andrew Ellicott when he was surveying the boundary between the United States and Spain along that 31st parallel. And there's ones you can actually get to. On one side it says the United States, the other side in Spanish said territory of Spain. It's got a little shelter over it. You gotta walk to it. It's about 300 or 400 yards off the road, but there's a path to it. But anyway, that you can see the border there just below Natchez, above Mobile. That's that border. And everything with that Roman numeral 1 is original territory. The Floridas would come into American possession piecemeal, which is a whole other presentation again, but just a really brief summary is that there was a rebellion over in near Baton Rouge area, established the independent state of West Florida for a while before the United States immediately annexed it. And then what is now part of Mobile and Baldwin counties and Mississippi Gulf Coast really came into American possession officially during the War of 1812. Now, the backstory of why everything north of the 32nd degree parallel became part of the United States, part of Mississippi Territory, is that Georgia was claimed, which again, I'm going to keep saying this everywhere we go. There's a whole other story we could tell about the fascinating twists and turns of how that happened. But again, I'm going to try to summarize some of this for you so you understand how things progressed. Georgia basically claimed that land. Where we're sitting now is part of what Georgia claimed is their, is a part of their colonial charter going back to 1733. They actually tried to settle it, divided into colonies, more than one occasion. You may have heard of the term the Yazoo Frog. That was the biggest, most famous attempt to do this. And Georgia, through a series of maneuvers, eventually rescinded this thing and repeatedly at the capital over in what was then Louisville, Georgia, the legislators were going to burn this corrupt document that was sullied with all kinds of bribery and manipulation and have the fire from heaven, have magnifying glass like the place. So start over. So basically that whole territory, through a complicated series of maneuvers, ends up being purchased by the United States and is immediately annexed into the Mississippi Territory in 1804. So that's how that second edition came in. Now when all this occurred, when you got the Mississippi Territory first established in 1798, that edition in 1804, you've essentially got a big chunk of land without any major American cities. This is still primarily Native American domain. The one major city that you do have is Nashville, which is, of course, down Mississippi. That is the capital of the Mississippi Territory. This was a relatively sophisticated place, fairly large for its day. Not anything huge by modern standards. Maybe had a population of about 5,000. It was the largest community anywhere on the river between New Orleans and all the way up into Cincinnati. This was a major metropolis of its time on the Mississippi River. And so the center of government for that entire territory is in the very extreme western fringe, right on the Mississippi River. You can might imagine that might lead to some complications for some people on the eastern side, and it did. The only group of American settlements of any size at the moment, and this is a map made a little bit later, just to show you the area. At the time, when we're talking about 1798 to around 1810, the only other pocket of American settlement of any size is down north of Mobile, Tensaw Delta region, Chombigbee, Alabama rivers coming together, Tensaw settlements, Tensaw district, several smaller little groups of settlements there, no major large city, but in the entire eastern half of this huge Mississippi Territory at the time, that is pretty much your major American settlement. And they did not really have a whole lot to do with Natchez. Natchez did not have a whole lot to do with them. We're going to pick up with that story a little bit later, but I want to put all the development of the territory on pause for the moment, because the one factor that overarches everything in Alabama's early development is this watershed event, Creek War and War of 1812. I'm not going to tell you the entire blow-by-blow of the war, but I want to tell you a few steps of it, because if you understand Alabama's territorial period, everything kind of is before the Creek War, and everything's after the Creek War. And after the Creek War, everything speeds up and Alabama launches itself into statehood. Before the Creek War, you've got a pretty sparsely inhabited, but very large, kind of unwieldy territory that's really not working together very well as far as politically and widely isolated settlements. The Creek War is what changes that. So I want to lead you up to the why that is. I know a lot of you have heard a lot about the Creek War. I'm familiar with the term and you know ultimately what happened. This what became Alabama had claims from several tribes. The Creeks, though, are the one large group that really had a serious presence in towns and ancestry in the area. Some of these other groups had smaller villages in the area, but primarily this was territorial claim for hunting and things like that. The Creeks, though, this was their homeland more than any other. This is where the concentration of their population was along the Tallapoosa, Coosa, Chattahoochee, Alabama River valleys. As many as 20,000 people. This is a major, they by far outnumbered any Americans in this territory. So these guys are feeling pressure from the east, from the growing United States. They're hemmed in by the Spanish to the south, other Native American groups in the state of Tennessee to the north. They're wrestling with this whole idea of what do we do? Do we accommodate this American civilization? Because a lot of their leaders were doing that, and they were basically living like Americans, that there were several creeks that owned slaves and plantations, things like that. And then there was a small group of creeks that said, if we continue on that path, what's going to happen is that we will not be Creek anymore. We're losing our own cultural identity. And this federal road that you see marked through here, which they have agreed to allow as a postal path to connect eastern United States with New Orleans. Basically, that path they allowed, that federal road, became, in their eyes, kind of an immigration superhighway. So all of a sudden, you've got all this conflict, and then you've got just a stream of settlers coming in, and the Creeks can see what's happening. They're growing alarmed, they're growing uneasy, they're wrestling with what to do with it, and lo and behold, here comes a gentleman named Tecumseh, whose name I know you recognize from Alabama history, claiming to have some ancestral connections to the Creeks in the south. He's from the Great Lakes area. He comes, we don't know exactly what he said when he spoke to the Creeks, but this is in summary, it's been handed down. He says something very similar to this, if not these exact words. He's basically preaching that all of you who are concerned about how to deal with this American encroachment, will unite, form a united front against this advancing tide of American westward expansion. That's the only way we're ever going to stop it. Because if we try to fight the piecemeal, we'll all be defeated piecemeal. So he says, let's work together. And he says this to the Creeks at the very time that the Creeks already started to divide among themselves about responses to American development. So you've got a minority. Historians aren't sure exactly the numbers, but I'm going to venture a guess of what I've seen, that maybe around 30-35% of the Creeks will eventually fall into what we call the Red State camp. A slight majority would have been actually allied with the Americans. They start fighting among themselves about this course of action. The people that are Creeks that become known as Red Sticks are the people who actually take up arms to defend and to stop this American expansion, while most of them remain loyal to the United States. So in the Creek War that's going to come after all this division, they're Creeks on all battlefields fighting with Americans against other Creeks, and a lot of people don't realize that. When the first begins as a civil war with the Creeks fight among themselves. They siege to each other's towns before they actually involve Americans. To understand the war, you really understand there's about three major campaigns, and this is all just really in a nutshell stuff. There's so much more that can be said, but just to help you understand the way it developed, is there's a campaign that opens up down near Fort Mims, which is, of course, the event in Alabama history a lot of people are familiar with, or usually have heard of Fort Mims and they've heard about Horseshoe Bend, which are more or less roughly the beginning and ending of the war. There's a little bit more to that story. But anyway, Fort Mims was attacked. Fort Mims was basically a settler stockade. The home of Daniel Mims. They built a stockade around it because there was tension, and they knew trouble might be brewing, and a lot of settlers, including Indians, had gathered in this thing. It was one of about 12 or 13 in the area. And it was attacked on August 30, 1813. A massacre ensues, and what happens is all across the Gulf Coast region and even beyond, the Northeast newspapers carry the story of this unprovoked massacre of innocent American settlers by hostile Creek Indians, fully unaware of the dynamics at play, which was the truth is a whole lot more complicated. Some of these Red Sticks were attacking that place because they were Creek Indians there who didn't take their side. So there's a whole lot more that they didn't understand, but the upshot is that immediately armies were raised, and that's Fort Mims today, a reconstruction of the blockhouse. Immediately armies get raised in Georgia, Tennessee, to put down this Creek Rebellion, and the Creek War begins in earnest. There's a campaign that few people seem to know a whole lot about. It comes from Georgia, actually two campaigns, make it into Georgia, fight two of the larger battles of the war in central Alabama, making their way from Fort Mitchell, which is a reconstructed historic site just south of Kansas City, and fight the Battle of Tossie, Battle of County Creek. Neither one of these has so much as a skilled marker today, which goes back to my theme. This era in Alabama history is kind of overlooked, and usually you just pick up history books. There were the French, there was Spanish and the British, and then we got plantations. And you kind of skip over this crucial era. But the campaign that most people are familiar with, especially in this area, I would imagine, it is the campaigns by Andrew Jackson, his Tennessee militia and regular forces that make their way steadily into Creek territory. There's Andrew. Andrew had a keen eye for logistics. I always like to point out those two oaks up in Fayetteville, Tennessee, were reputed to be the very oaks that gathered his troops under in Fayetteville and gave them their marching orders before launching into Creek territory. But in the distance, you will see those little bars, the spot there. Those are the lights from the Fayetteville Walmart. So Andrew Jackson, military genius, knew about supply and the distance. Makes his way into what is now Alabama. You know, David Crockett was with him. Remarks that they shot him like dogs, Tallahatchie. Ends up through a series of battles, actually cornering the large red stick army at the Battle of Horseshoe Bend. Andrew Jackson himself said it was one of the best constructed defensive positions he had seen. So he gave credit. These are Native American engineers, but they have erected pretty stout places to defend themselves. They're going to make the final stand here. Andrew Jackson arrives, and he tries to pound this place into submission with his cannon. Makes no advance whatsoever. His Cherokee allies and some other troops go around that bend of the river. They come around behind here, and they secure the canoes that the Creeks had placed there to escape should things go bad. And they hemmed them in. They get up. They cross the river. They began to lay fire to the village. Andrew Jackson sees the smoke, and I'm giving the 30-second summary here. But then Andrew Jackson realizes the time's right for a headlong assault, which he does. And he storms the earthworks there, the defensive barricade, and in the end result, it's the most Americans were killed in Horseshoe Bend than any other battle in American history. It was a stunning blow that kind of destroyed the Red Sticks fighting power at the moment, and basically wins the Creek War with that stroke. So it's a final campaign, but certainly not the only one. Now, after the Creeks were off to the bargaining table at the surrender negotiations, he, of course, forces in all the Creeks, not the ones who fought against him, but the ones who fought with him. Everybody is forced to surrender this 20-plus million acre swath of land in the cession of the Treaty of Fort Jackson. That shaded area you see, if you know anything about Southern geography, that just happens to be one of the richest cotton-producing areas in the entire South. That is where we start our story of Deep South Moonlight Magnolia Plantation era. This all starts with this land so rich for cotton production coming under American control right after the war. Now, there's a little bit of some other international things that are happening just to the South. Remember I mentioned this West Florida Rebellion. The United States had claimed part of West Florida going back to the Louisiana Purchase, saying it's kind of a specious argument, but basically saying that along with that Louisiana Purchase, all this other Spanish territory should come into their possession as well. So there were constant efforts by people living in the area to try to find a way to annex themselves to the United States, the one part of the United States, rather than a foreign country. Well, actually one group over in Baton Rouge took it upon themselves to kind of rebel and raid and capture a Spanish stockade and declare themselves an independent republic. Quickly, the United States annexed it, just like that. And they claimed the rest of the territory. They went so far as to designate, at one time, officers, civilian officers for Mobile and the Mobile area, even though the Spanish still had a fort and a garrison there and they couldn't occupy their post, but they were on paper saying, this is ours. It's eventually going to come to the United States by force of arms during the War of 1812 when Wilkinson is going to force the surrender of the fort there in Mobile. It's the only territory acquired by the United States during the War of 1812. But that completes our territorial expansion. Now, there is just an interesting story that a lot of you may not know related to the War of 1812. There are actually two War of 1812 battles fought in Alabama, both down at Fort Warrior, which is the exact same spot, where a generation or two later, a gentleman named Admiral Farragut was going to issue the famous words, "Damn the torpedo," was supposed to be hit. Same place, different war, different foes, generation earlier. The first attempt, they come to Fort Boyer, the British are trying to make their way to capture Mobile to go over into New Orleans, which would be a lot easier if you know anything about the geography of the area. They're trying to haul cannon and men through the swamps east of New Orleans. They repel. Stunning feat for the British. Now they come back after the Battle of New Orleans and then are defeated. But by the time they're defeated, word arrives that the agreement, peace treaty has been signed in Europe. There's Andrew at the Battle of New Orleans. Now, I want to shift gears real quick because I want to give you some overviews of some of the major themes of development in the area. So this huge swath of territory comes open as a result of the Creek War. And if you've ever read anything about the time, you've heard the term or seen a quote about Alabama fever, this is where it comes from. James Graham, writer Thomas Ruffin, November of 1817, he describes this desire to go to this newly opened land, this Alabama fever. He says that fever rages here with great violence. It's carried off vast numbers of our citizens. I'm apprehensive if it continues to spread as it's done, it will almost depopulate the country. There's no question that this fever is contagious. For one neighbor visits another who has just returned from the Alabama, he immediately discovers the same symptoms which are exhibited by the person who has seen the alluring Alabama. Alabama becomes a focal point for Western migration during this era and is one of the primary destinations in the entire United States for Western migration during this era. So in a really compact time period, right after the Creek War, Alabama's population is going to just explode, relatively speaking. There's another fact. I know some of you studied this time period and seen these same statistics and quotes, but they're remarkable to see. One traveler is traveling the opposite direction most of the traffic is going. He's going back on the federal road back to Georgia. And he reports in 1816, you see all the stats, 141 wagons, 102 carts, 10 stages, on and on. All these people are pouring in Alabama. Now, the numbers I always like to demonstrate, we'll talk about these numbers a little bit later. Individually, they don't sound, 3,000 to 4,000 people. It doesn't sound on the surface of it enormous. But when you're talking about an area that before the had an American population in the entire region of 4,000 to 5,000, these are big numbers. This place is really blowing up very quickly. There is one story I want to touch on that some people have heard. You've heard about the story of the French settlers in Demopolis, the Bounded Island colony that may be familiar, may not. It gets distorted and told incorrectly in a lot of places. But basically, Demopolis does have its origins in this migration of some former officers fighting with the French, fighting with Napoleon, who had been exiled, and some of those French who were in what is now Haiti, who were fleeing a slave rebellion, were offered some land by the United States Congress in this developing area in Alabama, and they do go up and they do establish a settlement, but a lot of them sell their land before they even settle there. So there's a romantic myth that early Alabama had all these guys in French uniforms, military uniforms, doing all this stuff. There were some French there, and the area does take its beginnings to it. But this whole binding off of colony thing kind of plays out very quickly, and a lot of the people who were given land that end up moving on to Texas or selling their land, etc. But it's an interesting story in the migration to this area. The other thing to remember is when we're talking about early Alabama, you're talking about an area that just recently came under American control. You can see some of the dates on this map. You're looking at these are accessions of Native American groups, and you see dates like 1816, 1805, 1819, on and on. Anne Royal put it really eloquently. She said, "This land was abandoned last fall by the Indians. The fires were still smoking when the white people took possession." Now, she's basically saying this is how quick this transition of land occurred. This was Native American domain, but up until suddenly it wasn't. It was an American territory. The Americans are going to populate it very quickly, and they're going to bring not only themselves and their families, but they are going to bring lots of slaves. That's a slave colony. They're going to divide up the territory and lay out flats. They're going to divide up towns. This is a map of Lakeland, where I work, still Lakeland State Park. A lot of towns get developed in this time period. Some endure, some don't. Newspapers, some of Alabama's earliest newspapers, of course, developed in this time period. This is an image of the Mobile Gazette commercial advertising. Steamboats, transportation, is a whole revolution. It's still a difficult comprehend today just how quickly transportation changed when all of a sudden you go from manpower rowing up the rivers that would take you 2 weeks to get from Mobile to Montgomery. All of a sudden, you've got steam transportation. It's a whole paradigm shift in the world.